Hey guys and gals, welcome back to our YouTube channel. This is for largemouth fans only. You know, I love the smallmouth bass. Let's get that white elephant off the room, okay, off our back right away. I love them. Why do I love them? Because they're everywhere. One thing about Canada compared to the United States is our distribution of, or especially in Ontario, of smallmouth bass, they're virtually everywhere. In largemouth bass, it's not the case because sometimes you get a little bit north of GTA in different areas, 3-4 hours north, and there's virtually zero largemouth bass available. Then you get really far north again. Northwest Ontario and largemouth are just booming everywhere as well. But no matter what pit, pond, river, stream, they have smallmouth bass, hence the popularity of smallmouth. And I do it too. I love it because I just love to go bass fishing. But when I want to catch big bass, real big bass, I go back to my roots. Primal instincts, okay? Casting rod, casting reel, 20-pound fluorocarbon, and I've got either a jig, or I've tied on beaver bait, creature bait, frog, something that I can hunt and just pull my hat down, glasses back, turn off the world, and just pitch, pitch, pitch.
I'm here, you. Look at him stuck in that stuff, hey? Stuck around a branch. Look, that's why I'm using the braid here. Oh, he might come off here. This is where you gotta go to him sometimes. No, I'm just mean. Because I'm on a big branch. If I try to bring that fish to me, I'm gonna bust him off, even with the braid. So I gotta go and get him. Come here, you. I know. You wonder what's going on, huh? You wonder what's going on, huh? Oh, boy. Look how thick that is. Look how thick that is. Look at that. Scary stuff. Look, you gotta punch it through that. That's what you get. He's not the biggest fish of the year, but he's a chunk of fish. Fish I can take a picture of, put them in the live well. But see the importance of just fishing slow and this kind of stuff? I know you guys are in there. Put them in there. Live well on. And man, I tell you, it's like methodical. You just gotta go slow and just keep going and going and going, pitching in the heavy stuff. Trolling motor gets bunged up, but you know the bass are there. Just a matter of taking your time, making those pitches, focusing on the pitch you make. You feel anything, that little slither rig, set hook. Let's go.
But when I want to have fun, man, I pick up my casting rod, pull my hat down, and I mean a saw plastic bait, rig weedless. I'm going to show you some of my three favorite ways to catch them in shallow water, heavy, crazy stuff, man, jungles. The kind of stuff you look at and think, man, that's line-busting stuff. Could bass really live in there? That's the appeal.
Look at that, eh? That's exactly what I mean, right there. Big fatty, too. Look at that. You just gotta find the stuff. Junky, little stuff. And look what sits in it. Watch this hook. Boom. I would've let off. I'm going to put some in the live well for some pictures, but it's just a matter of going slow. Trolling motor, power poles. You know, and believe it or not, I forgot my push pole in the truck, but I thought I'm just going to go slow today. But chunky, if you rush it, all you're going to do is spook fish. And you don't want to spook them in here, because then you got to wait till they calm down and come back and get them, all that kind of stuff. But it's just a matter of looking for the heaviest stuff in clear water. You know, there's a lot of mung weed. Like, look at this kind of stuff. It's just like tattered, nothing. Just looks like, you know, a field of hay and stuff like that. It's not really ideal stuff. But what the bass will find is the stumps, you know, duck blinds, docks, any moored boats, things like that, that are in this stuff. But this natural stuff, that's the key. Fishing slow, punching it up, put in the holes, shake it, and wait till they come over and find it and then eat it. Let's go.
hunting more than fishing. That's what this is. Just getting down one-on-one, you against those big, bad, green bass with the casting rods. Sit back, relax, have some fun, because I'm sure you're going to enjoy what I got coming up next with some examples of big bad bass, the baits, how I do it, so you can do it. Okay, bait number one. What is my number one choice when I've got a casting rod in my hand and I'm looking for big largemouth only? That's it, right there. Anything that looks like a beaver style bait, I've got tied on. I love the jigs, love the creature, frog, big swim baits, whatever it is, man. Something I can throw and chunk and wind and stuff and pitch and flip. But the beaver baits. And again, this one, okay, some of the ones have the little kicking tails and stuff. That's great to create a little bit more action. I don't want any action. I want to put this bait right on the nose of fish. So that means I'm going to the largemouth. I'm not making them come to me. I'm not creating any action.
At that time, eh? Oh. 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 There we go. I knew I had a bite there a second ago. Look how far back the hook is. Whew. I popped that slop a few times, huh? Popped the slop, put it on the edge, boom, missed it, put it back, and that's what you call luck, where you ate it. So I got a couple of twins for pictures, and that's it for the first day for me. That's a pretty good sized largemouth again too. Nice, thick, beautiful pig. I love you girls. We'll let you go and take some pictures of you.
The only action here is when I set that hook and the whole world goes just nuts, wild, because they're splashing and there's something down there that I want to see what it is. So the beaver bait with the non-kicking tails, just a subtle little thing, it glides down, but I'm putting it in such heavy, crazy, stupid jungles that it just falls through the different weights. I'll go through some of the weights and stuff. My 3/8 and 1/2 ounce are standard. But the 3/4, 1 ounce, when I'm punching through stuff that you could almost walk on.
Got nice kind of stuff in here. I haven't seen any fish really moving on the frog, but I missed two that try to eat that little split tail grub, but it's a lighter weight. So this is like a punching. It's not like 1/2 ounce or 1 ounce traditional real heavy slop like that. It's grass and pads and stuff. So I'm doing the same kind of method of punching, where I pitch up in the air with a slender beaver bait and go through there. So I just want to get through that mat. The fish do not get scared, but just getting through that mat where they're sitting on that canopy and then shaking it a bit, we'll see what happens. They usually find it pretty good when you put it inside there like that. You make a little bit of noise. Punch. Punch a largemouth. God, is that ever fun? Unbelievable. Wow. That mess. Shaking it and shaking it. And finally you see the line just go. Doop. Wow. Not as big as some of the other ones, but nice and chunky. So just let him go. All right, little guy. Wow. Go on. Whoa. Punch mat. God, that works. Wow.
It's the bait. It just glides through. It slithers through. I peg the tip of the hook point so you can get it through. And remember, this is about fishing the nasty stuff. Putting these baits like this little bait right here on their nose. That's the enjoyment of picking up a pitching stick, flipping stick. I don't catch a lot of fish doing it. I don't. Not on one outing. If I catch 4 or 5 in a day, that's been a fantastic day. And I've had some of those kind of days and stuff. But it's about finding the biggest, baddest bass of the day. Somewhere, somehow, I'm just going to do it. I've got the focus and concentration knowing that if I'm more stubborn than those largemouth, this isn't about tournament fishing. This isn't about proving anything. This is about me challenging those big largemouth. I will find you. I don't care where it is.
It does too, doesn't it? Oh, look at that one. Wow, what a piggy. In that mess. Hey, piggy? You were in that mess. I just knew it had to have somebody big and fat. Look at that. It just looks too good. Man, I probably fished for the last 45 minutes. Hoping, praying, pitch. Move slow, power pulls up, power pulls down, put in, put out, take your time. That's what you get when you take your time, punching through the pads in shallow, clear water.
It might be logs, it might be rock, it might be wood, it might be slopping pads and stuff. Every day is different. Because remember, those big largemouth, they sit and they honker. They're lazy, man. Lazy things. Sit and honker like an old dog under a coffee table waiting for you to drop a popcorn, okay? So I got to put this little bait right on or close to his little proximity, whatever zone he has, depending how much hunger pains he had in his stomach. Sometimes you can fluke them. Everybody flukes, man. It's the way it goes. When they're out wandering around, they're pretty stupid too. But putting a bait, like the beaver bait, on its nose, so all he has option to do is just go inhale, turn his big fat head, and start to swim away slow. The magic of seeing that line move, I can't even put into words description. Something about seeing that line move, you lift up knowing, I found you, boy. You ready to play?
Look at this one. What did I say about find those right holes, huh? Little piggy, huh? Oh, should I do that again? I mean, you big fat piggy. Look at that. That's a fat bass.
Okay, some of the products, you know it, man. When I'm throwing the beaver bait, in anything that's semi-clear and I got confidence that I won't break off, it's the 20-pound Gamma Edge fluorocarbon. Best line I've ever used in my entire life. Honest to goodness, man. You know, this stuff, it just won't break. Subtle, I can pitch, but something about always changing that casting reel, putting fresh line on, just gives me confidence. And when I'm fishing the real nasty, like the stuff that looks like a jungle below the surface, I go with a braid, 60-pound. Now you can go with 50 or whatever it is, but come on, a little bit difference between 40, 50, and 60. Is it going to make a difference when you're fishing those jungles? Not to me. And here's a heavy gauge hook, no opening. You see that? I'm using a lot of pressure and it's barely moving. Do not be dissuaded in thinking about all these needle point sharp hooks and things like that. You're wasting your time. You're not really fishing for big largemouth. You're not. Okay? Take it for what it is. Heavy gauge hook, so it just cuts through, doesn't tear holes. I heard that from a big name pro. Ain't gonna be name dropping, but he showed me that years ago. Heavy gauge hook has no bearing on largemouth bass because it makes a small hole, it stays, it cuts in, it doesn't tear. Tearing is a big mistake. So think about that. 4-odd, 5-odd. The 4-odd for me is perfect. Okay, second choice, soft plastic. Now again, I mentioned all the smallmouth around, okay? And yes, I do catch the big bronze ones in the same locations as the big largemouth, but I'm not targeting them. This is about largemouth, boys. 7.4, 7.6 rods. Heavy power, 20-pound fluorocarbon, heavy braid, rig Texas with a tungsten worm weight, the creature bait. It's just so subtle. I don't have to do anything. A lot of times I'm fishing such heavy cover, I don't have a lot of options to be working the bait, skipping the bait, swimming the bait. That's not about what this is about, man. This is about pitching, getting right inside, pulling the hat down, man. You know, turning off the whole world. I don't want to hear about anybody else's stuff. I just want to go fishing. I just want to catch big largemouth with my jig stick, flip stick. That's all I'm going to do. Don't call me. Don't text me. My phone's not on. I'm away from the world when I'm pitching and flipping.
Or what color of creature bait do I like? Obviously, this has got like a tea color, right? Stained, water's high, the bushes are high. Fish are all in that thick stuff. So black with the blue flake, can't beat it. I got, again, dark green pumpkin with black and green flake. Excellent contrast. Last but not least, green pumpkin with blue in there, like a blue craw. Three choices, two rods, gonna catch some bass. Oh yeah, on a creature bait, look at that, hey. Look at these things fight, man. Tough largemouth, eh? Come here, boy. Oh, good one too, eh? How's that for a start with the creature bait? Oh, look at that. Look at that. Think he wanted that? That's a solid bass, man. Ooh, anywhere. Tell you what, you just angle out here quick. Wow. He's probably 4.5. I don't know if he's pushed 5, but he's got a big belly too. Creature baits on this segment, man. I'm going to show you why I fish them. When the lake has largemouth and smallmouth, we're going to take some pictures of some fish, but I'll put them in there for now. Hoo boy. Hey, that a good fish. Look at that. Solid. That's why they call them big mouth, right there. Whew. Put them in for safekeeping. I won't put more than 2 in there, just for some pictures, but that's exactly what I was saying, hey? Exactly, man. Torn up, who cares? You know what? I use plastics that are really soft. You say, well, you get them free and stuff. Some I do, some I don't. But the softer baits get more bites and higher hooking percentages. See, when I pull into pads like that, I pitch in about 5 feet. The water's really high right now too, so I look for the thickest stuff. And I saw a bunch of stems with some opening, with other stems. And I think there's a log in there, because all of a sudden there was an opening in the pads. First pitch in there, doom, I just felt that familiar boom. You never miss those. So I just pegged the sinker, because this isn't about dragging the sand and making muck. It's about pegging and putting that bait exactly where I want it to go. Pitch in, free fall down, watch.
Life. This isn't about product endorsement or pushing somebody's stuff. This is about showing you some of the best baits that I use in the nasty for largemouth. So the creature bait would be my second choice. Beaver bait first, creature bait second. Okay, last but definitely not least, frog rod, okay? 7.4, 7.6, extra heavy power, okay? Casting reel, again, 60 pound braid, long cast, finding fish with this right here, Kermit, okay? Kermit goes in places a lot of people don't want to go. I'll tell you why I throw the frog a lot in slop and heavy cover. It helps me locate fish, shows me the mood of the fish, especially largemouth, because sometimes they'll just turn and the pads will move. I'll know you're there, okay? Because carp just make too much commotion. They put mud trails everywhere. It's not carp, it's largemouth in those pads. But sometimes they're just lazy. So they'll see the frog over their head and they'll just move their big fat body out of the way. That's all I need to see.
You know, the biggest thing with frog fishing, I know guys say it, they love seeing the explosion. I love seeing the frog get eaten and stuff, but man, I miss the bites. A couple things. Maybe you haven't got the rod with enough strength and stuff, but wait. Like I said before, man, especially like with these striking, sexy frogs, they're very soft. But the way the hook's design is, it comes along and it's almost like in the side of the baits. You don't have to worry about getting snagged up and stuff because I'm still hopping it with the rod tip. Some guys just use a steady little pull. Some guys just drag it like a mouse. I want to find fish with this thing. So that's my premise. If I find an area where they're blowing up and I have to work it slow, okay. But it's great to find fish, moving fish. And if you miss them still, you can pick up a craw or bug or rodent and stuff and throw it in. But having a bait that just comes along that stuff and it just shows you, it doesn't matter how deep it is, man. Largemouth can be in water that deep. If it's covering their back, use the frog. But it's all about the rod as well too. You gotta have a rod, and I use the braid because there's no stretch. So whatever velocity I use at the boat, that's exactly the exact same velocity that's gonna penetrate those hooks into that bass's mouth. So right rod, heavier line, braid for sure, and a reel with high capacity so you can make those long bomb casts. A lot of times you see me talk about fishing close to the boat and stuff like that. Not with frog fishing. And this brand new bullfrog rod, 8.8, I can cast it a mile like Brady. Throw it, twitch it, move it, and catch it with the frog. Sort of like that. Hey, the sexy frog with the bullfrog. Look, it's weird how you get them too. Like you get them all over the place. Look at, because there's no rhyme or reason. He got it at the bottom. So he's going to go back anyway.
When they eat the frog, it's a bonus, okay? But with the big casting rod, making lots of casts, I could be on an edge of a river channel or something, casting in. If I were to take all that time and effort, push poling through all those areas, and those fish are not located in those areas, I'm wasting time. As much as I love to pitch and flip and stuff, I like to locate them sometimes as well. And the frog, to me in that heavy slop, is number one. Virtually weedless, it attracts bites, but you can find those big largemouth quicker and faster.
It was on the outside. Yeah, told you. Look at that frog go, eh? Hey, sexy frog, meet the bullfrog rod. Come here, boy. Hey, wah! Just a decent fish again. Just decent, but it's the excitement of seeing movement in the water, casting the frog, and then fooling them with the frog.
And if they're not on the frog, when you think about those spots you're fishing, and they're great looking spots, you think, man, they should be slamming the frog here, and they're not. That gives you a key too to slow down, man. Put the frog rod down, pick up the pitching stick, pull your hat down, push your glasses back, stretch a little bit, and know that, guess what? It's the relievers coming up. It's the eighth inning. It's time to pitch, you know, get some strikeouts. So the frog helps me find them, but sometimes it's just a locator for those big bad ones that don't want to eat the frog, so I know they're hiding, waiting for me. So there you got it, okay? Three of my favorites. Beaver baits, always rig Texas, creature baits, and of course, the Kermits. One of these three, or actually I'll be honest, man, all three of these are always taught on before I go on a trip, pitching, flipping. If I know there's largemouth around, these will be tied on in the rod locker or in my truck. It's just a given. The heavier the cover, the better. Number one choice, beaver bait. Number two choice, creature bait. And number three, the frog. Sometimes they're way back in that nasty stuff you can't really reach with those long pitches. So the braid, heavy power rod, heavy hooked frog will get the job done. So I appreciate you watching our short series on For Largemouth Only. Okay. The next episode, I am going to be turning on the sonar once in a while. Shock! Only to help me find those little edges of things that have fallen from the shoreline that other guys drive over. They can't see with their eye, but those big, bad largemouth are sitting on fallen trees, first little breaks and things. I'm still picking up the nasty little plastics. The frog goes away. No froggy. It's the nasty stuff in a little bit deeper water. Appreciate you watching. Hope you subscribe. And we will be back next week with more For Largemouth Fans Only.